It's okay.
No, but you need to go around.
That's good. That should be good.
Hey, good morning, Unplugged. How's everybody doing? If you're grateful to be in the house of the Lord today, would you just put your hands together and let's say thank you to God for just allowing us to be here in this place. That was like the sexual chocolate clapping coming to America. We can do better than that. Come on, y'all. Be grateful for God being here on today. Put your hands together and just thank God. Amen. Lord, we're so grateful for this opportunity to be here today. We played a short video. Tomorrow, we will be celebrating the life and legacy of Dr. Martin Luther King, Jr. And obviously, he was a very man who was very impactful in changing our nation and taking a lot of chances and just exhibiting a tremendous amount of bravery and courage in doing what he did. And while the whole service today is not going to be, you know, in memories of him, we wanted and thought it was important to take some time out to just remember his life and remember his legacy and what he stood for. And that prayerfully tomorrow will not just be a day off, but it'll be a day on. That will do something and to remember his life and everything and all the sacrifices that he's made so that we can enjoy the freedoms and everything that we have on today. And so if you would you just stand with me? Want to say this short scripture? Take us to my scripture, please.
Thank you.
Receive my love. We want you to receive my love. God. You as a friend. dependency. She came up here with no reservation. And that's how God asks us to come to him. No reservation, knowing that what he gives us, where he takes us, where he leads us, his goodness is going to follow us, and that he's going to guide us every step of the way and make sure that when we make it to our destination, we are whole. We have this complete full joy that we experience and know the fullness and depth of his love. So that we can experience and know and be reminded of how good he is to us. And when we look back on our journey, our testimony will be,
to put them in the care of someone else. And I watched her faith and her husband's faith faith continue to grow as they begin to put their continue to put their trust in God. And so I celebrated with them when they brought their baby home. So one more time, while they're watching, would y'all let the Young family know that your Unplugged family is celebrating with them, and they're so grateful that Mariah is home with her parents. Also, if you go to my next ones, one of our brothers, he just went to Thailand this week. But if you remember Sergeant Cody McDonald, he got promoted to the rank of E5 on this week. And so most of y'all probably see him around here. Cody, he got promoted to E5. And so we were there at his pinning ceremony. His lady pinned him on and was all excited and everything. And so he's, I don't know if he's watching. I think he may have just gotten there or so. But he's in Thailand. And so we want to make sure that he'll be there until March. And even then, he was with us here on Wednesday in Bible study, even though he was getting ready to head out. So if you would, please. Keep a name. If you want to write it down, that would be great. We'll also continue to text and email you all. But Cody McDonald, and he's going to be gone for the next 2 or 3 months until March. He'll be back, so please keep him in your prayers. All right? For those of you that are new here, we're going to ask if you would look on the screens. They're going to put up our Connect card. If you would pull out your cell phones, as if this is your first time here, we want you to connect with us. We want to learn your name. We want to know who you are. We want to know about your children and all of that other good stuff. So if you just point your camera at that particular QR code, it will take you to our link tree, and we want you to hit the one that says Connect Card and fill out the information in there so that you can get to know us. I'll give you a call. Myself and Chaplain Staten will give you a call this week, and we'll just get to know you and your family so that we can see what we can do and how we can serve your particular needs. All right? We also want to let you know that we started our texting service. Thank you, Chris. Every one of you, how many of you all got the text message we sent out yesterday? All right, I see all the hands going up, good stuff. So that's our way of just keeping in contact with you and letting you know we're not going to spam you, not going to send out a bunch of unnecessary text messages, but just essential news to keep you plugged into what's going on here at Unplugged. So if you haven't been connected to that, again, that same QR code, you can hit that, or you can text at symbol unplugged, S for service, to 81010. All right, we held our first Bible study on Wednesday, amen? All right, so I know a few of you all that were here. We had some of the ones that can't be here on Sunday that came out. So we've been watching the Netflix series called Hellbound and trying to figure out how does the things that we see in the movie there, talking about sin and redemption and different things like that, and what are angels for, what are demons all about, and how does all of this stuff fit into what the Bible actually says? And we had a really good discussion. We ate some pizza, came together as a family. So if you're interested, I pray that you are, please watch the, I think we're on episodes 3 and 4 now. So if you would watch that series, we're going to use that to come in and have a discussion on what the Bible has to say about subjects like heaven, hell, angels, demons, about sin and salvation. And we had a really good discussion on Wednesday. We had about 10 or 15 people in our first Bible study. So we're really grateful to God for that. Amen. Oh, yes. Thank you, sweetheart. If you haven't had a chance to watch the series, it's not a necessity to watch the series. You can still come in and participate even if you haven't had a chance to catch up with us on this week. All right, again, all of our social media is up and running, our Facebook, YouTube, Instagram. You can connect with us on all of those platforms, whichever is your preferred one. And this month, we're going through a series called This Is Us, U.S., talking about the Unplugged service, getting people to know what we are as a church, how we are building ourselves, what our vision is, and how we operate here at the Unplugged service. Somebody say amen. Amen. Good stuff. Now, at this time, it gives me a great honor and privilege for the first time in my life as a chaplain, and also for the first time here at the Unplugged service, we're going to do a baby dedication. All right, so I'm going to put my mask on to make sure that we're safe, and I'm going to ask the Bachmeyer family if they would come and if they would join us. Woo! Come on, y'all, put your hands together for the Bachmeyer family. This is your family as well, so we want the entire family to come on up if you don't mind. We have their, go ahead, would you introduce your parents?
So this is my father-in-law, Richard, and my mother-in-law, Martha, and they are coming to us from Oregon, so.
Come on, family, make them feel welcome. Your parents came all the way up. All right, so, thank you, the lyric, you all over it. So, this is our family, Timothy, Rebecca, Kason and Ainsley, who was up here running all around and, you know, just being, you know, joyful and everything like that. And we're so grateful for them. So today, they're coming, acknowledging and professing their dependence on the Lord to raise their child, Miss Everly Bachmeyer. All right? So our opening scripture says this. In Mark, the 10th chapter, the 13th verse, the Bible says, people were bringing little children to Jesus in order that he might touch them, and his disciples rebuked them. And when Jesus saw it, the Bible says he got upset and said to them, let the little children come to me. Don't stop them, because the kingdom of God belongs to such as these. Truly I tell you that whoever does not receive the kingdom of God like a little child will never enter it. After taking them in his arms, he laid his hands on them and blessed them. And as a result of that scripture and what Jesus did, when parents have their children, they bring their children back to present them back unto God. And so that's what we're going to do on today. If you all, plug family, if you would, please bow your heads and pray with me. Dear God, today we come to present Everly back to you as a gift from her parents. As a demonstration of having received her from you, they now take her and place her back into your care. We remember on this day how Jesus called the little ones close to him, placed his hands and blessings upon their head, and threw his arms of love around them. A child's innocence is a cry for purity. Their weakness is a cry for strength, and their hopelessness is a cry for protection. And their heart longs to be loved. We pray that as Everly grows, she will grow in wisdom and in favor. Protect her in danger, send angels to guard her and strengthen her, that she may be sustained in moments of temptation, and lead her to accept you as her personal Savior. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Unplugged family, this is not just something that they're doing, but when we do this, we're doing this together as a family as well. Because it's not just the parent's responsibility to raise a child. Back in the old days, we used to say it takes a village to raise a child. And so we are all family. We rejoice together, we cry together, we mourn together. Whatever we do together as a family. So we are all not just spectating, but we're participating in this process as they bring their child to present them unto God. Somebody say amen. 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 So, Tim and Rebecca, as you present your child to God for dedication, we ask you, are you willing to rededicate yourself to the maintenance of a Christian home, one in which Christ will be honored and the word of God will be reverenced, so that she may, on her own free choice, confess her faith in the Lord and Jesus Christ and accept him as your personal Savior? If you are willing, please say we do. Amen. All right. Because you recognize the spiritual, physical, and moral responsibilities of parenthood and your dependence upon God for strength, wisdom, and to faithfully fulfill the duties of parents, do you now present your child for dedication, seeking God's divine blessing and guidance upon her life? If you do, please say we do. May I hold the child? Everly James Bachmeyer, we dedicate you and present you back to God in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Father, we pray that you would watch over this child all of her life, that you would be with her, and that as her parents, her community, her extended family, all of us come together to help raise her to know you, to love you, and to fear you, so that as she grows, she will grow to the place where she accepts you as her Lord and Savior. The Bible says that we train up a child in the way that it should go. When she is older, she will not depart from it. But this we give you praise. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, we dedicate you back to God. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Family, would you help thank God for the dedication of our first child here today? Chaplains, we came together and we wanted to get you a gift. Chap, if you would, We have it here. I think the most important thing we can give a child, of course, is their first Bible. So if you haven't already bought her one, then great. Then we're presenting one to you. So this is a child's Bible. We also got a card and a little gift in there for her. And this is a certificate of dedication. It simply says this is to certify that Emily James Bachmeyer was dedicated to God on today, the 16th of January, 2002, here at Evergreen Chapel, JBLM, Washington. At the end of service, we're going to sign this and make sure that it's all presented to you. Family, would you one more time help us thank God for the Bachmeyer family that we present our child back to you? Can we get a quick picture real quick, and then
for this day. We thank you, Lord, for this opportunity to be in your presence to hear from you. We ask that you bless this word. Let it be a life-changing word, a word that we can take from this place and stay in your presence. In your name we pray, amen. All right, so I've been gone a couple Sundays. You've been gone a couple Sundays too because of the snow. And then last Sunday, I couldn't make it to service because during the snowstorm, someone in my house caught COVID. And it wasn't me.
Yes.
And so, but I'm excited that I didn't get COVID. Anyway, I had to take care of my family, the quarantine and stuff, but God has truly blessed us. So we're happy to be back in the house. But I was able to watch the service online. And did anybody come to service last Sunday? Did you enjoy the time last Sunday? And we talked about this is us, what makes unplug. And then Chaplain Staten brought up the gold sheet. Can you put the gold sheets for me, please? And these are the sheets that we talk about when we talk about different areas of this is us, what it makes this service. We talk about prayer, Bible study, serving God, giving, and fasting. And I saw some questions on fasting, and so it was really, really good. And so we're going to continue with this is us and this Sunday and talk about worship. Can you go to the worship slide? And I heard a question. Someone in this area had asked the question. They said that one of their goals was to increase their worship. I know I thought about that, and I was like, you know what? That's probably the area that I need to increase as well. Because most of the time when we think of worship, we think about music. We think that worship is all about singing and singing nice songs, and that is not what worship totally is. That's a part of it, but it's more to it than that. So we're going to do service a little bit different. Unplug is probably not different at all. And I'm going to ask the Willis, the couple that's been married for 32 years, I'm going to ask that you guys to come up and join me and sit right here. We're going to do a little fun time for service today. And then I'm going to ask Benton, would you please mind coming up and sitting right here? Please bring your microphones. You will need them. You can share. It's okay, you guys. So, we're talking about worship, and while they come up here, I want to pull up the scripture, John chapter 4 and 23. John chapter 4 and 23, if you're taking notes, if you're going to jot stuff down, this is the one scripture that you jot down. But the hour is coming and is now here where the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. For the Father is seeking such people to worship him. He's looking for true worshipers. What does that mean? Does that mean if you can't sing well, you're not a true worshiper? No. Does that mean because you don't come to church every single Sunday for whatever reason that it means you're not a worshiper? No. It's all about the relationship. So we're going to talk about a few things. And during this session, you are more encouraged to ask questions. This is not a typical sermon where I'm going to stand up here and talk the whole time. But I want to get feedback from you and feedback from our couple that's here. And so the Bettons right now, they're going to represent what I call a dating couple. They're dating. And all this is in the Christian context, by the way. So we're going to keep it kind of PG as much as we can. Amen?
Amen.
I mean, unless y'all want it. Never mind. I ain't doing that. It was my job. All right, so the Bettons will represent a dating couple. Please, can you move it? You're dating, sir. You're dating. Can you move your arm? Yeah, you're dating, okay? Stop trying to, you're doing too much, And then the Willis who've been married for 32 years. Wow. They're going to represent what it means to be a married couple. I taught a class before, and this is how I view kind of the praise and worship, type of the worship relationship. A dating couple is simply that. Anybody can date. Dating is all about seeing the other person and trying to look good for them and saying hey and maybe buying a couple snacks and candy, taking them out on dates and having a conversation, but it's totally different from what it looks like to be married. Married, you don't get the date and then drop them off. You got to go home with them. You got to stay with them. You got to be with them during the good times and the bad. You got to be with them during their weakness and when they're strong. You have to be with them. All is totally different from dating. The difference between dating and being married is real simple. It's all about the relationship, being committed. Now, there's things about, in the Christian context, there's things that this couple can do, that this couple can do. They can go out on dates. You can have a good time. You can enjoy yourself, but so can you. You can go out on dates. You can have a good time. You can enjoy yourself. You can dress nice and look good, put on some smell good, you know, do your hair, make it up. You know, Chuck Daddy got to have at least 3 or 4 Nikes that he wears each day, right? I know how he is, right? So he do. But you guys can do that too. But there's some things that this couple cannot do that this couple can. Should I say there's some things that they should not do? That's the one. For the sake of the children getting here, I'm going to call it eating ice cream.
All right.
This couple over here can eat ice cream anytime they want to. It don't matter what flavor they get. They can put swirls. They can mix it up with flavors. They can eat it in the kitchen. They can eat it in the living room. It doesn't matter. They can do whatever they want. This couple right here should not be eating ice cream. Should not be eating ice cream. And the difference from a relationship from worshiping God is that sometimes all of us can praise God. Anybody can say, God, you're good. God, you're awesome. God, you're loving. God, you're caring. God, we appreciate you. Any couple can, anybody can do that. But to have a relationship with God and to be intimate with Him looks something totally different. Amen? Y'all with me so far? So far? Okay. So, number one. All of life is worship. All of life is worship. Can you go to the next scripture, please? Now, when I saw this one, I definitely want to get some feedback from you guys. It says, so whatever you eat or drink, or whatever you do, do all to the glory of God. One more time. So whatever you eat, or whatever you drink, or whatever you do, do it all to the glory of God. When do we worship God? Always. In every single thing we do, in our conversation, in our talk, in our walk, how we treat others, how we treat our partners, how we speak to them, how we represent God is all about worship. If you're only coming to God and worship Him on Sunday morning, you're dating. If you only come to God and when it's time to come to church, and that's the only time you open up your Bibles is that Bible study, then you are dating. Because you need to spend time a little bit and then separate again. But when to worship God is to say, I'm going to read my Bible, I'm going to sing praises, and I'm going to stay with you. And I'm gonna go, if I go to the store, you're going to the store with me. And if I'm going down the street, you're going to the street down the street with me. And if I gotta buy some ice cream, you can be there with me when I get the ice cream. You following me? Any comments? Anything you want to point out, please? At all? We good? Go for it.
When you think about the commitment, it's deep. Mm-hmm. It's so much deeper in a relationship. In a marriage, you know, we were in. He's in. I was 25. He's 30. He deployed, I think, 19 times, and it had to be deeper. It had to be a commitment. I'll share a simple thing with you. We were at church, and I was on the altar right before church was going to start. And one of the ladies is right here. I said, I'm interceding for my husband every time he has to go into battle. He would call me and sit in. I had to get on a helicopter and check on my service members because he was in a joint assignment. And I got to go and fly into the zone. And he said, pray for me. Stay on your knees until I call you back. I would stay on my knees and pray for him until he came back.
What she said.
Now, I was going to comment on the ice cream comment in that in dating, sometimes you might have a cheat day and taste ice cream, not supposed to have it, but there's a difference when you are, when you can have it guilt-free. You can indulge guilt-free in that moment. There's, you know, I know certain kinds of ice cream. I know certain, areas in my life where, and I'm talking about worship at this point, you know, where I'm, as someone who is dating or kind of dabbling or, you know, I haven't really committed fully into that relationship with the Lord. There are moments where I experience him in a worship setting where the presence of God is there, and I may not have completely committed, but man, I got a little tear crying. I don't know what this is. It's a little weird. But I feel something here. But when I am married and when I really lean into worship and the intimacy of worship, I know what this is. I look for it. I crave it. I desire it. When I am weak, I am looking for that place of worship because that's where I get my strength from. So, you know, everybody can praise, you know, we come and we clap. And yes, there's a general understanding that God is good. We can all agree with that. But once I commit to the intimacy of worship, there's a different level of, it's not just cheating to get a little ice cream. It's, man, I am having a rough day. I need that ice cream. I need that time with the Father. I need that, and I know that it's the source. I don't just kind of trip up on it on a Sunday service. It's Thursday at 2 o'clock in the morning, and I know where to go to get that place of joy and peace.
I just want to say real quick so you can get that discernment. And in the context of a relationship, God is always the pursuer. And so he's always the one that is pursuing us and being good to us so that we will want to enter into that relationship with him. He knows that we're dating. He knows we're going to have those off times. But it's not like we have to keep going to God. He's always the one that's pursuing us so that we will desire to enter into that relationship with him. That's all.
Now, I want to... So let's add something to this. All of life is worship. And I'm about to help. I don't know if you caught this, but I'm helping some people with their marriage at the same time talking about worship. Just throwing it out. All right, free chicken. So, this part tends to be a little bit more emotional. She hinted at that. It tends to be a little bit more emotional. Oh, look what he did for me, flowers. Oh my goodness, he loves me. He let me eat the last piece of his chicken. Oh my goodness. Over here, it's emotional, but it's past that. Hey, little girl, did you eat my chicken? Hey, girl, don't go eat my food no more. We should go together. It tends to be a little bit more emotional versus here. It's not about the emotion, it's about the commitment. It's honesty. I get to see you at some private parts of your life that nobody else wants to see. Okay. You allow this person to have access to you. Over here, you are allowing God to have access to you to see some parts of you that you might not show other people. Over here, we typically want to look good, but you're not going to see me at certain times because I ain't got my face beat yet. I ain't got my haircut. Over here, you get to see at the worst and at the best. And it's not so emotional. It can be, but the commitment here is that it's all about the other person. In worship, it's all about God. Being totally committed to him in everything you do, in everything you eat, in everything you say. Number two, we must grow in worship. You know how we do that? Can you go to the James 1? This one's going to be a good one when it pops up. There we go. But be doers of the word, not hearers only, deceiving yourself. Be doers of the word. You ever been in a relationship or on a date with a person and you didn't really act like yourself?
I'm the only one.
I'm the... Okay, you ever been, you been on a date before already? Okay, all right, he's like three, so. Anyway, I've been in a date, and it wasn't all of me, it was just enough to participate, to be a part of the person, to see if I even want to have a conversation with this person. But over here in this marriage part, it's not about just going on dates, it's about doing what you say. It's about being committed even when you're not in the presence of the other person. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
It's being doers of the word. How do you worship God? How do you increase your worship with God? You have to be doers of the word and not just hearers. It's not enough to come to church and hear a good word. If you don't do it, you're not worshiping. Yeah. you look so good. Oh, you're so beautiful. That's so great. Blah, 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 blah. And then you break up. And then we ain't committed. I don't like you. Why you said that to me? Blah, 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 blah. Versus over here, you better treat it right. You don't have a choice. It's not about, he's not about just saying this stuff. It's about doing it. Does that make sense? Anybody make sense? What do you guys think? Being doers of the word, not just hearers. What do you think? It's all right.
No, the last part that you said about, what comes to mind is trusting the intention. Like, when I'm dating, I'm getting to know you, or I'm keeping you at a distance because I'm not entirely sure what your intentions are for me. Do you want good for me? Are you good for me? So there's a level, arm's reach. But in worship and intimacy, in my marriage and even in my relationship with God more so, I always trust the intention of who it is that I'm worshiping. Or who it is that I'm in connection with, I'm in a relationship with. No, even if my husband does or says something that offends me or that hurts me, I can forget quicker, should I say, because I trust that my husband did not do that, did not say that, did not do that with the intention of causing pain or hurt. Even if it was misunderstood, it came from a place of love and a place to build what we have. Same thing with God, more so. Even if where I am right now is not comfortable, doesn't feel good, I don't think it's good, I can trust the heart of the Father because I know that it's coming from a good place and that it's not meant to hurt me. It's not meant to depress me or whatever the case may be, but it's meant to build me. I can trust him because I trust his heart. And that leads to intimacy and worship because, okay, God, I know this doesn't feel good, but if I'm being honest, I don't like it, but I trust you. I trust you in this moment, and I'm making you bigger, knowing that what you want from me is far greater than what I can want for myself. So I'm going to go along with what it is that you're doing right now.
I think adding to her comments is when I get up in the morning and throughout the week, the month, the year, my whole focus is on how is what I'm doing going to bring honor to God?
Yes.
And if it's not going to bring honor to him, then I'm choosing to not do that. And in a dating situation, it's different because I'm going to do what feels good to me. I'm going to reach out for those things that's probably not the best for me. And oftentimes I tell my married couples, there's not a single thing for a married man. There's not a single thing for a married woman. Meaning that we have to separate ourselves from those things that are not good for us, and it's not going to bring goodness and pleasure to God. And let's focus on Christ.
What
do
you say?
I want to go over one more point. The difference between a true worship, go back to John chapter 4 and 23. John 4:23 should be the last one. One more scripture. The very last scripture. There we go. But an hour is coming and is now here when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father is seeking such people to worship him. As one version said, that God is seeking a true worshiper. What is the difference, what's the difference between these two couples? It's only one thing. It's the level of their relationship. It's all about the commitment. How do you know you are worshiping God? It's through your commitment to him. One time I was on a plane, and I was flying home from a TDY, and I sat down in my seat, and there was a young lady who sat on this side. And I spoke, I said, hey, we're going to be on a flight for about 5 hours, and that's it. And I said, hey, I spoke, she had a service dog, I said, oh, it's a nice dog, blah, blah, blah. I put my headphones on, and then we got home. When we landed, my phone beeped, and it said, someone would like to send you a picture. And I looked at that thing, and I put a note. do? What did I say? How did I look? That let her know that it was okay to send me a picture. Did I not have my ring on? Did I not speak like I was married? Did I not project? What did I do? And I could have been over-exaggerating. She could have just messed up and did it by accident. But I want to know what I did. Because I want to be a true husband. A true worshiper. People will recognize who you are. Are people looking at you and can they tell that you are a Christian? Can they tell that you worship God? Can they tell that you have a relationship with Him? It's all about the commitment, the relationship. That's the only thing that's different. And you guys can break up anytime you want to. You can stop. I'm talking about in the dating passport area because he ain't going nowhere. you can date. You can break up anytime you want to. You can not be together. You can say, hey, this is it. I'm done. But over here, to stay together means something. Even when you don't agree, has God ever told anybody anything that you didn't agree with? Anybody ever gotten in a fight with God? It ain't really a fight, it's just you yelling and God looking at you like, what? But anybody ever? I have. Because I didn't agree with what God was saying. But because I wanted to worship Him, I didn't go anywhere. Alright, God, you in this one. You right. It's all about you. It's not about me. Does that make sense? What do you think? Anybody, any questions in the audience? I know we're kind of flying through this, but anything you want to add? Anything you think, you say? It's a little bit different. Not really a sermon. Okay, go for it.
You know, I think about people dating, it's not a full commitment. When you marry somebody, you take their name, take their family, you take everything. Because I know some people are single, they buy houses together, they get back in the house together. But when you commit to someone and you marry them, it's a whole different level. It's a whole spiritual level. There's a whole different level of accountability that comes along with saying, I do. Just like giving your life to Christ. We can stand and play church. But when you give your life to Christ, it's a different level of accountability. Because you become vulnerable to the Lord. When you get married, you become vulnerable to that partner. Hey. And I also want to tell all married couples, stop looking at the world to define your marriage. The world cannot tell you how to live a godly life. The Bible does. You can't go, because a lot of people think, oh, he don't buy me this, or she doesn't do this for me. They don't have sometimes the finances to do those things. The means to do it. And we go into debt to do those things that's not even really what our relationship is about. So think about those things. When you're in a relationship, what is it that you want to build? My husband and I came from two different kind of relationships. His parents were married. My mama was the king, the queen, and everything else. We come from the same household. So we had two different schools of mind that we had to build our relationship differently than what we saw. How we spent money, how we invested, how we moved in and goals together. Because we can't base our relationship on our family. And definitely not the world. Because the world will teach you the wrong thing and have you angry and mad because you want things that it's not your time to have.
There's, in a marriage relationship, my wife walked in on me one time when I was in the bathroom. I don't like people to be in the bathroom when I'm in the bathroom.
Amen.
I can't stand it. And she walks in with me while I'm in the bathroom. I won't tell you what I was doing in the bathroom, but I was using the bathroom. And she wanted to have a conversation. Oh, I can't stand it. I don't like it. But she wanted to have a conversation with me while I was in the bathroom. There was one time I was in the shower, and I walked out of the shower, and my wife walked in, and she saw me, all of me. And there's some, I won't show you exactly where, but I had surgery, and there's some parts of my body that don't look 100% to me because I had surgery. Because they cut me, and they left some scars, and some wounds, and some stuff that I wouldn't show the whole world. But my wife walked in and saw all of it. And I have to be comfortable with her seeing me at some of my weakest points or at some of the areas that I believe that are messy that I don't want her to see. In worshiping God, it's going to be some parts of God He's going to invade your space and see some of the dirty, messy places in your life. And you have to be okay with it. He's going to see some scars and some places that you got cut and that you were hurt that you wouldn't allow no one else to see. But to worship God means exposing yourself to Him so that He can help you. So that He can be a part of your life. How do you worship God? Let Him see all of you. Every single thing about you. And then when you walk out those doors, you represent God in everything you do, everything you say, everything you eat, every place you go. That's how you worship God. So when you come here on Sunday, Sunday is not about you experiencing God. Sunday is all about us experiencing what God has done for you. And then we all get to worship, and then we all get to celebrate what God is doing. Anything else to add, please?
Yeah, one of the things I really love about being a Christian is, Chris, if you could put that scripture back up, when it says the Father seeking this type of worshiper is the person who will worship Him in spirit and in truth. And so that kind of goes exactly what you're saying, bro. It's like, I love God because I know I can be honest with Him.
Yeah.
When I'm struggling, when I'm messed up, in a dating relationship, I'm not going to go to her and say, hey, I did this. I may keep that part hidden. But in a marital relationship, there's supposed to be that intimacy where I can be honest and be truthful and know that my marriage is not going to dissolve. And that's the thing that I love about being in Christ, is that I know how He feels about me is not going to change no matter what I did. He did not enter into a relationship with us based upon our behavior. And so our relationship is not going to be maintained based upon my behavior. It's His work that determines our relationship, what He did on the cross and everything for us. But I love the fact that I can lay it out there on the table, because let's be honest, God already knows it anyway. It's not like He don't see what we're doing in private, but He creates that atmosphere where I know I can go to Him in truth and be honest and know that it's not going to change the circumstances in our relationship.
And I will caveat and just say, like, just like every marriage relationship is different, it looks different, your relationship with God may not look like the person sitting next to you. It's your relationship, because you are a different person. So He knows you. He loves you. He loves us all the same, but the way that we receive and interpret that may be different. You know, the way that we express that may be different. You may see me jumping and running and you know, I smile when I worship in song. But that may not be your vibe. Like, you may be a reserved person. It may be just a quiet, you know, I am thanking Him, or I may lift my hands, I may cry a tear. You know, it may look different throughout the week. The way that you express that may be different. You know, you may be, there's not a vocabulary that's for Christians. You know, when I'm talking to you about God, I'm talking to you just like this. You know, I don't speak in King James Version. You know, that is not the standard for what an intimate relationship with God has to look like. So, you know, the honesty part, you know, in spirit and in truth, is this is me. This is us. This is me. And this is my, as I'm building my personal relationship with God, not the church, but with God.
Can you put up that goal sheet? And this is the last thing we're going to do. Put that goal sheet one more time. And I want to show you something. And so, we talked about reading our Bible, prayer, worship, serving others, giving, and fasting. Reading our Bibles, praying, worshiping, serving others, giving, and fasting. This is us. Prayer is nothing but communication with God. If you are dating or married and you're not communicating with the other person, I would tell you to be careful. That would be the right thing to do. Serving others. Marriage is about giving to the other person. How can I help you? What can I do? What am I bringing to the table to make us stronger? giving to the other person. Just, hey, I want to bless you. I want to be awesome in your life because that's what I'm here for. What can I do to help brighten your day? Fasting. It's another form of just sacrificing, of saying, you know, I'm going to take less of me out for more of you. Reading your Bible, understanding the other person. What makes them tick? What makes them move? What makes them smile? What makes them frown? All of these same things could be tied into a relationship, but could also be tied into worship. How do you worship God? How are you going to worship God this week? By reading His Word. Understanding who He is, by praying, by communicating with Him. Increase your communication. If you want to increase your marriage and do better in your marriage, increase your communication. But it works the same thing with God. If you want to improve your relationship with Him, you got to talk to Him more. Not just praying over your food and not just praying when you go to sleep, but communicating with Him, serving others. How can you be of service to God? What are you giving to Him? And then how are you making sacrifices so God can be glorified in your life? This week, I want to challenge you to increase your worship, your relationship, your commitment to God in everything you do, everything you say, everything you eat. Let God be glorified, and that is how you worship. Can you imagine this place if all of us individually had increased our worship dramatically throughout the week? What would happen on Sunday? It's another thing we do is we say you should get around like couples. Get around couples that got the same goals, the same career, and the same aspiration as you do because you help strengthen each other. Imagine if all of us increased our relationship with God and then we came here to strengthen each other. Imagine how powerful that service would be. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for this time. Lord, I know that this was different. This is not your typical Sunday message or sermon, but Lord, we wanted to talk about how do we increase our worship with you. And so, Lord, as we go throughout this week, help us to increase our worship in everything we do, we say, who we are, who we hang around, how people perceive us. Do they know that we are in a committed relationship with you? And if they don't know, Lord, help us to work it out. Not to be judged, not to be criticized by other people, but to increase our relationship with you. Then, Lord, as we continue to make these goals for 2022, that worshiping you would be a top priority. And we give Him the glory and the honor. In your name we pray. Let everyone say amen. 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 Can you give these guys a hand? Thank you guys for helping. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Amen. Wasn't that a phenomenal message by Chaplain Staten? Thank you so much, and thank you for the Bentons and the Willises for actually coming up and helping us out as well. If you would, please stand on your feet as we prepare to dismiss. I want you to think about this week. Think about what Chaplain Staten talked about with worshiping. And think about not only worshiping here on Sunday mornings, but what does worship look like throughout the week? How will you give your all and give your best to God? And so I want you to leave this place thinking about what you're going to do to give your all to God. This is us. Let us pray. Almighty God, we just thank you for this opportunity today to fellowship with one another and worship you. We came today to give of ourselves, to give our best, and to give our all to you. Lord, this is us, unplugged. Lord, we've talked about some of the goals of our service. Now, as we talk about it here, we are prepared to go out and live it on a daily basis. Let us start with what Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. said about service. Everybody can be great because everybody can serve. And so, God, this week, as we worship you and as we serve you, Lord, we want to turn around and also serve one another. Lord, this is our prayer as we leave this place, that we would worship you, and through that worship, that we would turn around and serve others. Lord, this we pray in Jesus' wonderful and magnificent name. Let the church say amen and amen. God bless you. We look forward to seeing you at Bible study and also on next week. God bless you all.